As Canada began to take shape in the 19th century, Indians began to be regarded as a problem. In 1857, legislators in Upper Canada debated an act to encourage the gradual civilization of the Indian tribes in this province. It was becoming accepted wisdom that Aboriginal peoples had to somehow be fashioned into the image of the Europeans who had settled here, to farm like them, to be educated like them, and to worship like them. The government-funded, church-operated network of Indian residential schools and the provisions of the 1876 Indian Act were intended, in the words of Duncan Campbell Scott, Superintendent General of Indian Affairs, to kill the Indian in the child, and to assimilate First Peoples into Canadian society. Over the next century, these government initiatives resulted in epidemics of poverty, disease, and addiction among Aboriginal peoples that left many of them living in third world conditions within one of the world's wealthiest nations. The Government of Canada apologized for these policies on June 11, 2008. Faced with such socio-economic challenges and the lack of a national political presence, First Nations had neither the resources nor capacity to deal with outstanding treaty and land rights issues. Besides, since 1927, the Federal Indian Act specifically outlawed the creation of Indian political organizations, much as it had banned Indian ceremonies, language, and dances. In the Liberal government's 1969 White Paper on Federal Indian Policy, treaty rights were called an anomaly that should be equitably ended. This electrified Native leaders across the country and resulted in the 1982 creation of the Assembly of First Nations as the official political voice of over 600 chiefs. The resurgence of regional organizations such as the Union of Ontario Indians helped to make treaty rights and over 800 outstanding land claims the subjects of national attention and debate. Three high-profile standoffs in the 1990s involved First Nations people protesting government refusal to recognize their treaty and land rights. This raised the issues to their highest ever level of national awareness. In the summer of 1990, over 3,500 Canadian troops were mobilized after the Mohawks of Conestoga refused to allow the town of Oka, Quebec, to build a golf course on a traditional burial ground. Police fired over 70,000 rounds of ammunition in the summer of 1995 at Gustafson Lake in British Columbia after a group of occupiers refused to leave a traditional Sundance site. And on September 6, 1995, Anthony Dudley George was shot and killed by a police sniper when unarmed Native protesters camped in Iprawash Provincial Park to protest Canada's failure to return nearby land expropriated in 1942 for use by the Canadian military. The Oka crisis led to the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples, a five-year inquiry that produced 440 recommendations, one of which for a new royal proclamation committing Canada to a new relationship with First Peoples and companion legislation, calling for a new treaty process. In issuing the 2007 report for a two-year inquiry in the death of Dudley George, Commissioner Sidney Lindon referred to the significance of the Royal Proclamation of 1763 and the wampum belts given to the Anishinaabek at Niagara in 1764. Every Ontarian should understand that this province and our country were built upon the treaties negotiated with our First Nations, he said, and that everyone shares the benefits and obligations of those treaties. Today, some Canadians see treaties as artifacts of another era in their history, with no current relevance. First Nations people view treaties as living agreements that respect their status as nations, as recognized in the Royal Proclamation of 1763. They see this as their inherent right, referred to in Section 35 of the Canadian Constitution. Another more forward-looking definition is emerging. First Nations leaders and some more visionary members of Canada's corporate and political sector see treaties as the catalyst to help make Native communities partners in Canada's prosperity by respecting their spirit and intent to share the country's wealth. Some jurisdictions, like Ontario, have demonstrated an understanding that everyone benefits when concepts such as resource benefit sharing are part of the province's economic plans. Treaty promises will be fulfilled when First Nations children can look forward to accessing the same educational opportunities, the same quality health care, and the same job prospects as their neighbors. That is a vision of nationhood. That is Tecumseh's vision.